morning, everyone. How's everyone doing this morning? Lovely, peachy keen. Fantastic. My name is Matty Taus. Thank you for being here at Epiphany Station with us. I really honestly hope you get what it is you're looking for this morning. You get what you need. Just to give you all kind of up to speed, what we're doing this morning is we are in the 10th message in a long series, 12 weeks long, that finishes in a couple of weeks here, in which we have been going on a journey as a church to try and understand what real faith looks like, what solidly built quality faith actually looks like, and how we can make sure that as a church, that's what we're constructing as opposed to anything else that we might feel like we want to be representative of God. So that's what we've been doing. So over these 10 weeks, we've been going through a small book in the Bible called Colossians. It's only 4 chapters long, and we're at the end of chapter 3 today. And really, this book has been great. It's honestly, it's a primer on how to know God better and better and become more like his son, Jesus. And like I said, we've been doing this for 10 weeks now, and this same book has been teaching Christians how to grow, how to mature, how to know their God for centuries. So that's what we've been doing. It was written by a guy called Paul to a bunch of kind of younger, fledgling Christians in a city of Colossae, hence Colossians. And he wrote it to help them understand how they can continue to walk solidly and get to know their God and to grow and mature in their faith. Before we dig into our discussion today, though, there's a couple of things I want to point out to you, and they're in the program that you were handed as you walked in. If you didn't get a program, you're missing out. The programs act for a couple of reasons, have a couple of purposes to them. The first is to look really cool with our graphics, thanks to Nolan. The second is to have a space on the inside to take notes on the message because it's so well articulated, you're really going to want to remember it. In the middle, there's usually information about what's going on. Like this week, we've got community fun night that we do every Sunday night at Hearts Park at 6 p.m. But the best thing I think about this entire program is this piece of paper on the side, which you can tear away with exact perfection. And on here, we are going to find your connection card. The connection card is your golden ticket for communicating with us as a church, or me personally, or one of our staff. If you want to let us know that you have prayer requests, or care requests, or you want to give us some information or feedback about one of your experiences, or heck, if you think that we could be doing something different or better to reach more people for Jesus, we'd love to know on this connection card. You fill it out as much as you're willing, and you can drop it in one of the two red boxes as you leave today. Also, another kind of thing for you to be aware of if you're checking Epiphany Station out is you're going to get to the end of experience and realize that we haven't passed a big gold shiny plate in front of your face. Instead, we don't pass a plate at Epiphany Station. We have the red boxes. We have a card reader. We have giving online. And that's intentional. We haven't done it. We haven't passed a plate for nigh on 10 years now. And that is because we don't want guests to feel pressured to give. If you give at Epiphany Station, you want to support the mission financially, or you want to give your offering to God here, that's awesome. We give you the tools to do that, but don't expect a plate. So jumping into things, like I said, we're in chapter 3. And chapter 3, we're starting to get towards the end. Paul starts what you think is a wind down into finishing off his letter, but he doesn't really step off the gas at all. In fact, if you've been here over the last couple of weeks, or you've been watching online or catching up, you'll know that Paul is getting things more and more personal. He's kicking over more and more rocks and opening more and more wounds and talking about, you want to be like Jesus Christ? Let's talk about what that looks like. Let's be honest about making that a part of who we are. So he's been, in the last chapter, in verse 10, saying things like, you don't get to live how you lived. You need to put on your new nature, your new operating system. You need to put your faith and make Jesus Christ your most important thing so you can know your Creator and you can become more like him. Verse 17, last week he said, whatever you do or say, understand that this life is not about you. Whatever you do or say, do it to represent Christ to everybody else. And then he goes another step deeper this week into getting really in our lives, in our homes, in what we do and how we act and how we behave, and how he expects us to act like Christians. Because he's going to tell us to do some stuff today, and no one likes to be told what to do. Some of you might know that back home I was a mountaineering instructor, and there was once an occasion that a guy walked up to me, and he was going to try and tell me what I should do if I get lost in the woods. Terribly insulting. But anyway, he went ahead and said, just don't worry about it. If you get lost in the woods, here's a couple of things to remember. One, there are laws of nature that are going to work on your side. Solid laws and rules that will definitely benefit you in this situation. So what you do is you don't keep walking, you just sit perfectly still in the location you're at. If you want to be rescued, you want to be found, you want to be saved, all you do is you start declaring loudly, your views on breastfeeding, gun control, and politics, and like that, somebody will be there to correct you, and thus you are saved. I'll be honest, I stole that joke from Dale Anderson this week. But we don't always like to be told what to do, but that seems to be the job of everyone, you know, to tell people that you're doing it best and to tell them how they should be doing it. We get that everywhere you go. You can't go on Facebook 2 minutes without seeing it. And if we're going to come into a conversation today in which we're going to learn and try and understand how God says he wants us to do life, we have to come with a little bit of humility and just an idea, an inkling of an idea that we haven't perfected our lives yet. That we don't have all this squared away, that we're not running everything perfectly, and that maybe, just maybe, Paul and God's inspired word has something to say about how we can do life better. So if you're a wife, we've got something to talk about today. If you're a husband, if you're somebody's child, if you're an employer, or if you're an employee, we've got something in our conversation for you. If you don't fall into any of those categories, honestly, I don't have anything for you today, and you can leave, and you can frankly leave our planet, because there's no way you don't fall into one of those. But before we get in, like I said, Paul's going to get a little bit controversial, shall we say, so I'd like to lead us in a little bit of prayer before we take the plunge, if you don't mind. Father God, I thank you for your word, and that it doesn't pull punches, and that it declares boldly and honestly what you say is the best way to do life. Help us to take what is in Paul's instruction, take what it is and see how it impacts our lives and how we can love people better and how we can show your love in our relationships. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we're going through Colossians 3:18 and then all the way into the first verse of chapter 4. And this is what Paul says in a section that's entitled Instructions for Christian Households. Paul says, "Wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting to those who belong to the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and never treat them harshly. Children, always obey your parents, for this pleases the Lord. Amen. Fathers, do not aggravate your children, or they will become discouraged. Slaves, obey your earthly masters in everything you do. Try to please them all the time, not just when they are watching you. Serve them sincerely because of your reverent fear of the Lord. Work willingly at whatever you do, as though you were working for the Lord rather than for people. Remember that the Lord will give you an inheritance as your reward, and that the master you are serving is Christ. But if you do what is wrong, you will be paid back for the wrong you have done, for God has no favorites. And masters, be just and fair to your slaves. Remember that you have a master in heaven." Exactly. Pin drop. Now you know what I'm talking about when I say there's some heavy stuff and some controversial stuff in here. So why? Why does Paul give us this instruction? Why is this in the Bible, God's word? Why does this feature at all? And why, after chapter upon chapter of Paul talking about setting our sights on the things of heaven and the glory of Christ and the Almighty God, do we now get parenting tips? Why is it that he talks about this new life in Christ, how everything can be different and how we can change our entire lives, and then he talks about slavery like it's a legitimate thing? How is it that he talks about Christ being the only one that we submit to and that we serve and that we worship, the only one worthy of that, and then he talks about wives and children and slaves submitting to people? Why is it that Paul now follows up all these high-sounding theological things that we learn about our God with, quite frankly, things of this earth and things that seem disconnected from that? Well, there's a few reasons, and we're going to get to all of them, but I want to start with the most obvious. What Paul has been talking about for weeks and weeks and weeks and chapter and chapter and chapter is real life change. Like, to the core, life transformation. You're not going to be the same on the other end of this. And what he follows that up with is, it's got to start in your home. It's got to start in your place of work. It's got to start in your closest relationships. Basically, what he's done for people is said, here is what you're going to try to achieve in a Christian life. Here is how you're going to do it. And the place that you're really going to grow, the place that you're really going to implement this stuff, is going to be in the hardest arena possible. It is going to be in the most feared theater of war you can think of. Your home. You're going to do everything we just said about making sure you're fighting your sin and killing your sin nature. You're going to put Christ first. You're going to fill yourself with the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and you're going to have to do that where it's most difficult to do. I believe that there is nowhere better for us to test and to be tried and to grow in being like Jesus Christ than in our homes and in our workplace. Because you think about it. You try and fight off your sins when your spouse and your kids are running riot. You try and fight off your sins when you're sitting in your home alone at night. You try and make Jesus Christ first when the bills are rolling in and you don't know what to do, or you get a huge bonus from work. You try and fill your life with the gospel of Jesus Christ when the TV is on, or they just shut off your power. None of these things that come naturally to us to be able to be more Christ-like are easy, but they are harder at home and at work. So Paul says this is where we're going to start. We're going to actually get this stuff done. We're actually going to make life change where you're going to find the hardest to do it. It's easy enough just to hang around, you know, like-minded, shallow Christians in which we all pretend everything's okay. But try doing this in your home. Try doing this every day. Try doing it on a Monday morning. So he says, wives, you're going to submit to your husbands. Husbands, you're going to love your wives, never treating them harshly. Children, you're going to obey. Slaves, you're going to work hard. Masters, you're going to be fair. And this is the second reason that he says this. The second reason he gives his instructions to the Colossians is it's controversial. Now, we hear this stuff, and it's controversial. Talking about slavery, talking about submission of the wife. These things kind of grate on us just a little bit. In our society, in our culture, what we've come and grown up in, this is kind of different. But the real reason that he wrote it, the real reason that it's so controversial is because of the controversy it would have caused when he wrote it. We can read this and we can see, well, that's just a woman-hating, slavery-endorsing hate letter. The way that Paul wrote it to the people he wrote it was something quite different. Because not only did he write this to say it needs to start in your home, he wrote it to say your new life now has to fight against your old culture. Your new way of doing things needs to come against the way that society has been teaching you and directing you for centuries. So let's talk about that culture that Paul's writing into. Pre-Christ, a lot of Middle Eastern, a lot of Far Eastern culture was honor and shame societies. They were based on how much honor you could attain and grasp for yourself and to make sure you were never put to shame, never seen as less than anybody else. That was your job, to promote yourself, to climb the ladder socially. That's how you showed you were doing well. That's how you brought honor to your family name. It also meant you didn't care for other people as much. There was not so much love to go around, and there was not so much compassion. Now you take that and how that had been directing people's interpersonal relationship for centuries, and you find quite different marriages, quite different families, quite different workplaces than from what we're used to today. So marriages back then, they weren't love-based relationships. They weren't, you know, absconding and getting married by Elvis in Vegas. Marriages back then were legal contracts. They were things usually drawn up for a couple of legal benefits. So men could get heirs, so women could get security and not have to earn a living by prostitution. You talk about kids. Kids had no rights. Women had no rights once they were married. It was all under the man's subjugation. Talk about workplace. Well, we just did that. Slavery. Slavery was rampant and it existed. So something is definitely different about that culture from what we exist today. And if we can understand that, we can see that Paul's letter is controversial in a very different way. Because what Paul is actually trying to do towards this isolated, individualist, prideful, loveless culture is trying to shine a light of how it should actually be done Christ's way. And although Jesus had actually basically started a movement in which people thought that Christians were just social and cultural anarchists, Paul tries tactfully to steer the ship of culture, society, and relationships back towards the way that Christ wants it to be. Without capsizing it and without incurring too much wrath and hate from the culture they live in, he said, no, this is how we're going to do it a little bit different from what you have experienced before. This is how you're going to take this new life that Christ has given you and what he says, that everyone is created equal and to be loved and no favorites. And you're going to try and do this in this ugly, loveless culture that you're living in. Now, that's their context. That's what Paul was writing into. So the question we have to face is, well, what does that mean to us? We don't live in a country with slavery, at least not on the surface. It's not as rampant as it used to be. We don't have inequality in the law between men and women, especially when it comes to marriage. So what is it in here that we can learn? What it is that we can grasp? What can we know that Paul is saying about how to relate to people, how to love people, when our culture is different from the one he was writing into? Well, we have to be able to ask, and we have to be able to say, is this pointless? Is this dated? Is this worthless? Do we cast this aside because it was written for a different time? Well, I think we can answer that by asking some of the questions to see if we've got this perfected. how we're doing as a culture at marriage. The divorce rate would suggest not very well. How are we doing at parenting? The Taos House would suggest not very well. How are we doing in the workplace? How are we doing with relationships between friends, between employers, between employees? How are we doing in relating to each other? I would say not very well. I would say as the years go by, we tend to be more polarized, more filled with hate and confusion than ever. So maybe we have got something still to learn, and I honestly believe that we still need to be led by God's word and Paul's instruction on these things and to understand how it lays into our lives. So we're going to go through them. Each of those relationships and the one that's really bugging you and annoying you right now, we're going to talk about it a little bit more. And I'd love to talk to you personally about it if you have an issue with what I'm about to say. So let's start with wives. Colossians 3:18. Wives, submit to your husbands, as is fitting for those who belong to the Lord. That's an uncomfortable sentence, isn't it? I'll be honest, that's uncomfortable for me to even say. I grew up in the age where you didn't say submission to a woman. Quite frankly, that's the F word in feminist leading homes. You don't talk like that. So what is it that Paul's really talking about? Because he says submit. He does. So if you take that submit, which is the English word for the translation of the Greek word hypotasso. Hypotasso being to graft yourself in to something else. To make yourself one with that which you are now partnering with, but at the same time, to make yourself second. That's what it means. Now, you take hypotasso out into the rest of the world, and it's a bit more acceptable. You know, you're going into your workplace, and you make yourself subordinate to your boss. Maybe not willingly, but you want a paycheck. Or you go out and you have friendships in which you serve other people humbly, or you do charity work, and we find ourselves serving other people, doing it in humility and submitting ourselves to what they need and their honor. We find that easier. It's often celebrated in our culture, but why not in marriage? Why is that so difficult? 3:19, husbands, love your wives and never treat them harshly. So women have to submit and all men get is just love, and that's freaking easy, right? If you're a dude and you're married, I want you to put your hand up if you've never treated your wife harshly. Awesome, Ted. That's one. Everyone go to Ted for marital advice. Or Jan. Jan might be the one you need to be talking to. That's one. Out of this service and that service, one person out of hundreds of men. It's not so easy to never treat your wife harshly. And when you really talk about love, it's not the diluted Hallmark version we think of. Love in God's tenets and what he's actually commanding men to do and husbands to do is do this. You need to love your wife in a way that is patient and kind, never being jealous, boastful, proud, or rude, never demanding your own way, never being irritable, never keeping records of being wrong, never giving up, never losing hope in it, never losing faith in it, and getting through every circumstance. That's the kind of love men are commanded as husbands. Doesn't seem so small. Doesn't seem so achievable now, does it? So why is it that men through the Bible and men throughout history have had to put it in front of themselves again and again and again? Love your wife. Isn't that just inherent in being married? Love your wife. Love her well. Don't treat her like crap. Just love her. Why is that so difficult for us? 3:20:21. Children, always obey your parents, for this pleases the Lord. Fathers, don't aggravate your children or they will become discouraged. Why can't kids just do what they're told? Someone answer that question for me and you can preach instead of me. Why is it that they cannot hear the words coming out of my mouth and simply obey what I've told them to do? Why? I know why. Because I was a kid and I loved being disobedient. It was fun. But why is it that they can't do that? Why is it not ingrained into them to just be obedient kids? Why are we still struggling as adults to be obedient to our folks? You ever gone home? Family reunion, you still can't find yourself being obedient to your parents. You want to do it your way. I'm an adult now. Why is it that parents are always getting aggravated and frustrated with their kids and actually causing them to be discouraged and causing harm to their kids because of how we treat them? Why is that so difficult? 3:22 through the start of 4. Slaves, obey your earthly masters in everything you do. Try to please them all the time, not just when they're watching you. Serve them sincerely because of your reverent fear of the Lord. Work willingly at whatever you do as though you were working for the Lord rather than for people. Remember that the Lord will give you an inheritance as your reward, and the master that you serve is Christ. Masters, be just and fair to your slaves. Remember that you also have a master in heaven. Now, not considering slavery, but maybe who we work for or who works for us. Why is it so difficult for us to treat each other equally and respectfully in the workplace? Why is it so difficult for bosses to see that their employees have another life, they don't own them, that they have vacation they want to take, that they have to support their families? Why is it that employees don't see that they're working for an organization and they're there to add into it, not just leech from it? Why is it that it's very difficult for us to see that the other person's point of view or the time off they want or their perspective is just as important as mine in the workplace? Why is that so difficult? Well, I have a theory. My theory is that everything that Paul has directed us to do is to be Christ-like in all of our relationships. And being like Jesus Christ isn't easy. It's easy to be us. We're really good at being us. It just happens that being us sucks most of the time. The potential for all of our relationships is that we get to actually grow in Christ-likeness, because those relationships are where we're actually going to prove it. We're actually going to put down our metal, put our rubber to the road and say, yes, this is what we're going to do, because it's tough. We also have the potential to just be more like us and to exemplify us and to give people a model of us. Another reason why I believe it's so difficult is because I think it's the struggle that's been happening since day one. I believe the very first time that a man and a woman entertained the idea of sin, which is basically to do the opposite of what God wants you to do, is a struggle was born out of it. This struggle was control. Think about it. When the woman is approached and said, you can have everything, you can be in control, you can be like God if you'll just do what God told you not to do. And the results of what she actually got was less control. The results of what the man got out of it was less control. And the decision that they made and the decision that we make and every decision of divisiveness and sin causes division amongst us around the subject of control. I mean, really, when you look at it, Genesis 3:16 is the result of sin. And what God says to his wife, you will desire to control your husband now, but he will rule over you. In that moment which sin entered into a relationship, what happened is an equally created woman, created perfectly to partner with her husband, is now going to frustrate herself with trying to control him, to manipulate him. And a husband who was created to protect and to serve and love her is now going to rule over her because he's bigger, stronger, and such. Immediately, relationships got smashed to bits over this question of who is in control and how much control can I have. So now we have wives who tear into their husbands, who put them down, who manipulate them emotionally and sexually because that's where they have the control. It's like the old Greek comedian used to say, the man might be the head of the family, but the woman is the neck. Where the man might think he is in control, the woman will actually tell him where he needs to go and where he needs to turn. So what we have in our culture now is men are honestly beat down. They're beat down and they don't know why. They don't know why that is that they feel like they're not involved in the relationship. And what happens is they lash out. They check out, or they leave. We have husbands treating their wives like crap. Honestly, awfully. Treating them like they have some sort of rights over them. Tyrannical and abusive. Treating them not like an equal partner, but something that is subject to their needs, their desires. And we have women going into these relationships with these men where, quite frankly, they're looking for the most love they could ever attain here on earth. And they're getting into them and finding that they're more hurt than anything ever. So they lash out, or they check out, or they leave. We have parents doing everything they can possibly do to try and control their kids. To try in some way to put a leash on, try in some way to corral them, try in some way to keep a hold. And we have kids who don't need any education whatsoever, are PhD level of controlling their parents. They have got an ATM, a chauffeur, and a maid living in home. This is the perfect setup for them. No wonder they don't go away. All based around control. We have bosses who honestly will view their staff as their property, as their slaves. They get to tell them what to do. They get to tell them when they can and can't go away, when they can and can't do this. And they see them as owning their time. We have employees who actually go into organizations and into workplaces knowing that they're going to be a leech, knowing that they're just going to try and draw as much as they can without giving as little as they can back, all based on trying to control. So this is why we need the instruction, because we might call those things normal, and we do. Those dysfunctions amongst relationships, those are very normal things for us to find. But normal is not best. And normal is not, should be something that we just settle for, is that's how it happens, or that is how it is. Because God has a different plan. And if we aren't willing to do something different, then we can't expect a different result. If we're not willing to do the difficult, we can't expect it to get better. And if we're not willing individually to bring Christ into our relationships, we can't expect him to show up in them. So this is why Paul directs us, trying to send us down a different path of relationships. And this is why God's word seeks to enlighten us, to shine a light into every area of our life, even our marriage, even our parenting, even our work, to show us that there's a better way to do it. So this is why God gives the call to hypotasso, to submission, for us to understand that we submit to one another, that we humbly serve each other, seeing ourselves as second, that we love one another in tenderness, with compassion and mercy and grace, that we be obedient to those who are over us, in charge of us, have authority, that we show diligent, hard work, no matter what the pay is, no matter what the job is, no matter who's watching, we work hard, and that we treat people with fairness and justice if we are in positions of authority. And the reason this is God's call is because that right there is Christ-likeness. That right there is what we've been talking about for a couple of months. And the only reason it now sounds more difficult, it sounds a little bit different to us, is because we just placed it in real life circumstance. We just placed it where you'd actually have to do it. Because what Paul's actually talking about is the character of Christ played out. Submission, love, obedience, diligence, and justice. You'd have to go a long way to find a better description of who Jesus Christ is and was than that list right there of how Paul says we need to be. It's going to be difficult. It's never going to be easy. No one should ever say that it is. Because to do it, to be like Jesus Christ, you have to go completely against the grain. You have to fight and work against your sin nature. You have to beat off the desire and lust that you have for control, the need to be first and the need to feel most important. It takes an individual being able to put their pride aside, say sorry for what they've done, ask God to make it right, and then live every day after that in worship. Because when we're doing it God's way, we're not working a job. We're not raising a kid. We're not getting married. We're worshiping. We go into each area of our life with an element and an attitude of saying thank you to God for what we've been given through him and through the relationships we actually have. When we see it through God's eyes, we see that he has granted, he has blessed, and now we worship him with all these relationships, showing people what Jesus Christ is actually like. So when we get frustrated with our kids, when you get in an argument with your spouse, when you have your debate at work, when you're in that meeting, when you have to correct one of your staff, when you have to confront your boss, when you have to correct anyone, when you have to be in a relationship with any individual across the face of the earth, you have to ask yourself, how am I growing like Christ in this relationship? How am I choosing to do it different and to do the difficult? How am I glorifying what God can do by taking someone like me and showing off into how he can make me a bit more like his son? That's what we're called to do. And it's the most difficult challenge of a Christian life, is to continually push towards that and never feel like we've arrived and never feel like we've perfected it. There's five parts to why it's so hard. The first is the submission. We have to submit our ways and put them to death so God's ways can live. We have to show love, obedience, and justice in our relationships, because that's what God showed us through Christ. And we have to have diligence. Because if you've been doing this for any number of years, you know that this is a process. And it feels terribly slow. But we need all five. Because if God's going to take marriages, loveless, prideful, dead marriages, and turn them into humble, loving, where the Christ of character is exuded towards both marriages, we're going to need all five. If God's going to get involved in broken family units, blended family units, difficult family situations, and actually instill authority into parents and give them that right and knowledge, and actually make kids obedient, then he's going to need all five from us. if God's going to get into the workplace and replace the venom with love and actually make your work actually feel like worship, he's going to need all five from us. God is interested in doing something with your life that you may have never fathomed. He's interested in changing the world. He's interested in breaking the chains of inequality and racism and sexism and ageism, xenophobia, and even division within our own churches by us being devoted to what he says is Christ-likeness. It cannot be something we wish to happen. It needs to be something we commit to. In my life, I will be submissive. I will be loving. I will be obedient. I will be a proponent and a champion of justice, and I will show diligence in everything that I do so that God can use me to change one person, two people. So God can change my wife. So God can change my kids. So God can change my church, my workplace, whatever it might be. So God can use you for what he's intended to use you for and for the difficult. Because we have to be ones that choose to do the difficult. Most of the people won't. We have to be willing to choose in the difficult time, in the difficult place, to do the difficult thing and to choose and to embrace and to commit Christ-likeness above our likeness. And in those arenas, in those theaters of war, in your home, in your workplace, to perfect it, to keep working until it is absolutely, immaculately perfect in the way that you know how to love people. Because if we want to be like Christ, it means being like less of me. And all that takes is giving God all of you. All it takes for us to be more like Christ is to say, God, I am all yours. Everything, every piece, every corner, every element, every crack, every blemish, yours to turn into what you need to for your glory, for my world, and for Christ's name. That's who we need to be as church. That's who we need to be as Christ followers. And the question that has to be posed is, what's stopping you from doing that? What's stopping me from doing that? What's in the way in which we actually don't want our family to enjoy a Christ like me? Why do I not want my colleagues, my staff that I work with, to not enjoy a Christ like me? Why do I not want to enjoy a Christ like me? What's in the way? And is it so important to me that I won't be willing to let God change me from the inside out? As I pray in a second, I want you to think about that. I want you to actually list what is in the way, what you can't give up, what you won't give up, and the areas that God needs to get into your life. Think about those, pray about those, ask God to work on those. Would you pray with me, please? Father God, I ask that you would highlight for us what's stopping us. What's stopping us from responding to the offer you've given to change everything, to take the old us, to put it away, and to bring out a new us that which we can actually exemplify Jesus Christ, exemplify your perfect Son. What have we got going on that's better than that, to make us realize what that is and for us to be willing to see it for what it is, as garbage, as just rubbish in comparison to you? Help us to be a people, no matter where we're at in our journey, no matter if we've got a relationship with you yet or not, that we would just start to see the things, they would start to pop up daily, the things that have us clinging on to the old us, and the opportunities that we have in our arenas of influence, in our theaters of war, to be able to fight those things off and to see spiritual growth actually happen and transformation take root. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
So here in just a second, we're going to take communion together. And communion is a practice that Jesus commanded the church to do regularly. The first example of this is in Matthew 26. He says, as they were eating, Jesus took some bread and blessed it. Then he broke it into pieces and gave it to the disciples, saying, take this and eat it, for this is my body. And he took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. He gave it to them and said, each of you drink of it, for this is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people. Poured out for the sacrifice to forgive the sins of many. And so we take communion to represent the body of Christ broken for us. He made the way for us to be right with God. This blood and this body broken to cover our sins. And so the way we do communion here, you don't have to be a member of Epiphany. You just need to be a follower of Christ. And if you're making that decision today, or if you consider yourself a follower of Christ, you're welcome to take communion with us. They're going to pass trays around with the bread. There's a gluten-free bread option, and it's a non-alcoholic juice. So just take some time to connect with God. We're going to play a song here. We just invite you to pray and to worship as you see fit. I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me.